samskaramatrajanyam yajnanam smaranam uchyate. That is, the respective sense organs give rise to the knowledge of the respective objects. So tattat visheka jnanam, such, and you have the knowledge of the, you have auditory perception, you have visual perception, you have tactual perception. So the respective sense organs give rise to the respective knowledge of the objects. And such a kind of knowledge is divided into two types, dvividam parikirtitam. And what are the knowledge can only be of two types, two varieties. One is some smriti or recollection, and the second one is anubhava. So all the philosophers, they always define smriti, and then that whichever is different from smriti is recollection is anubhava. Anubhava, there is no positive definition given. So first, although anubhava and then only smriti, we say in the sequence, you know, first there is experience, and experience leaves out a samskara, and then it gives rise to smriti. So this is the sequence, but yet philosophers choose to define smriti first and then only anubhava. So he defines samskara matra janyam yajnanam smaranam uchyate. Samskara matra janyam jnanam smritihi. Smriti or recollection is a kind of cognition, samskara matra janyam, which arises only from smriti. So now this definition says samskara matra janyam jnanam. What is the process involved here? First, there arises anubhava. You have the experience of an object, say pot. You experience a pot for the first time and you know that it is a pot. And what happens? It leaves out an impression or samskara whenever you have the experience of any object. That experience is bound to leave a kind of impression in you, and that impression is called samskara. Now, due to some extraneous factor which would kindle this samskara or the impression, there would arise what is known as smriti or recollection at a later date. So anubhava janyaha samskaraha, impressions cannot be had without anubhava or experience. So anubhava gives rise to samskara, and samskara in turn gives rise to smriti when there is the revival of samskara. So samskara means that is latent impression which exists in the self, and it gives rise to smriti at a later date when it is revived. So when once you recollect an object, the samskara, what would happen to that samskara? Because samskara has already given rise to smriti, for that it is said that samskara, the more and more you recollect an object, samskara will become firm, and it becomes drida. So when smriti goes away, that leaves out an impression. So what happens? Again you recollect, and then when that recollection goes, it leaves out an impression. So in this way the process goes on and on. So whenever you recollect something, that impression has taken the form of smriti, and when that smriti goes away, that leaves out an impression. So in this way the process goes on. Now let us analyze this definition of samskara matra janyam jnanam smriti. Now in this context, I would like to refer to what is known as upeksha jnana. Upekshana, there is a kind of cognition called upeksha jnana, and this is defined as smrityajanakam jnanam, that which cannot give rise to smriti. So it is not the case that all kinds of experience would give rise to recollection, because it appears whenever we say samskara janyam jnanam smriti, whatever be the kind of anubhava you have, that leaves out a samskara is not the case, because in some cases there is also a kind of cognition jnana called upeksha jnana, where it cannot give rise to any recollection, which means it doesn't leave out any kind of impression in you. What is that? When you are walking on the road, you are able to see many persons crossing you, cars, so many things are happening. But somebody puts you a question, did you see somebody crossing over, or did you notice this car? Did you notice the number of this car? Did you notice somebody who is sitting inside the car? All these things you are not, because it has not been recorded or registered in your mind. You are just able to say that something passed by my side, but I'm not sure what kind of, who was the person sitting there. So all these, there is a knowledge, but in spite of that, that knowledge, no, you cannot even call this as a nirvikalpaka jnana, because nirvikalpaka jnana means you are directly in contact with some object, but you are not able to determine what it is. You have to make a distinction between nirvikalpaka jnana and upeksha jnana. Upeksha jnana means you are not attentive, or you are not giving a bit of your mind to comprehend that object. If you had just looked for a while, you might have noticed what color was the car. So you have to make a distinction between nirvikalpaka jnana and upeksha jnana. In the case of nirvikalpaka jnana, you perceive the object, but yet you are not able to explain what it is. But in the case of, because you do not know, you perceive partness, everything, but you do not perceive them as visheshya, substantive, and prakara, adjectival element, so you are not able to express what it is. That is a kind of, that's called indeterminate perception. Such cognitions have to be distinguished from upeksha jnana. Upeksha jnana, we want to be very specific in defining upeksha jnana. That is, it is a kind of cognition which cannot give rise to any kind of recollection. That means you have not been attentive in comprehending that object. Such cognitions are called upeksha jnana. Now, so we have to make a distinction. Upeksha jnana, there are kinds of cognition which do not give rise to any kind of recollection. So upeksha jnana, naturally, upeksha jnana cannot give rise to any samskara. But such is not the case with anubhava. If you have been attentive or you have been receptive in the class, naturally it would have left out a samskara in you, so as to be recollected later on. So the process is this, that whenever there is a kind of anubhava, if you have been attentive, and if you have cognized the object carefully, then it is bound to leave a samskara, and that samskara would give rise to smriti. With this in view, it is defined, the smriti is defined as samskara matra janyam jnanam smritihi. Now if we analyze this definition of smriti, it arises from samskara. So samskara is the cause of smriti. Samskara gives rise to smriti. So samskara, when it gives rise to smriti, he says samskara matra janyam jnanam smriti. Smriti arises only from samskara. Now in the case of smriti, as a matter of fact or as a rule, smriti always implies the absence of the object in front of you. Whenever you recollect something, that means the object is not in front of you. You are recollecting Mahatma Gandhi lived in India, means the object is not in front of you, just recollect the object. So samskara, when it is revived, it takes the form of smriti. So samskara matra janyam jnanam smriti. Now he analyzes the prayojana, the purpose of each word in this definition. Now what does it matter if I say, well, smriti is a kind of knowledge. Smriti is a knowledge. Is it not enough to say, how do you define smriti? Smriti is a type of knowledge. Now if we say smriti is a type of knowledge, then this definition will be overlapping or over applicable in the case of anubhava, which also is a variety of knowledge. So it is like identifying a person at Tirupati. Somebody says, no, it's a tonsured head, you know, you can go and find him. He would have tonsured. All are there tonsured. So you will not be able to distinguish that person where he is actually. So you must supply a definition for whenever you define something. The definition must be an exclusive feature in the object defined. So jnanam smritihi, if you give this as definition, then it will be over applicable in the case of anubhava. So you have to give an exclusive definition. So you add the phrase samskara matra janyam jnanam smritihi. Now, if this is added, then what happens? Anubhava is not samskara janya. On the other hand, anubhava gives rise to samskara. So, there is no ativyapti in the case of samskara. I am sorry, anubhava. So, jnanam smritehe lakshanam ityukte anubhave ativyaptihi. So, to ward off that, you add this phrase. Now, what does it matter if I, let us for the moment forget this matrapada, samskara janyam, let us not have jnana. Samskara matra, samskara janyam smritihi. Smriti is that which arises from samskara. If it is said, then he says, the samskara gives rise to smriti. When it gives rise to smriti, what happens? There is the destruction of samskara. So samskara, by getting destroyed, then only it gives, if samskara and smriti cannot coexist, samskara gets destroyed and then there is smriti. But when smriti goes, it gives rise to samskara again. So, there is samskara dhvamsa. So, samskara janyam jnanam smriti, samskara janyam smriti, if it is said, this samskara janyatva can be had even in samskara dhvamsa. Just as smriti is samskara janya, in the same way, samskara dhvamsa also is samskara janya. So, the definition of smriti will be applicable in the case of samskara dhvamsa. So, in order to ward off that ativyapti, you use the word samskara janyam jnanam smritihi. The word jnana will exclude the possibility of the definition being over applicable in the case of dvamsa, because dvamsa is a seventh type of category, whereas jnana comes under qualities according to the Nyaya school. So, samskara dvamse ativyapti varanaya jnana padam. Now, where is the need for samskara janyam jnanam? This alone is enough. Where is the need for matrapada? Then he says, there is a kind of cognition called pratyabhijna or recognition. Now this recognition, the usual example that is given is soyam devadattaha. This is that devadatta. Now in this case, devadatta, whom you have seen earlier at Chennai, you are meeting him at Veliyanad today. So this is that devadatta. You are able to identify him as the person whom you have met earlier at Chennai. Now, in this case of Pratyabhijna, the person is in front of you. It is not like Smriti. Smriti does not involve the presence of the object. So, Devadatta is directly in front of you. In as much as you are able to see Devadatta, it is Pratyakshanubhava. It is a kind of Pratyakshanubhava. You are directly experiencing him. And at the same time, if you don't recollect that he was seen by you earlier at Chennai, then there is no use on, you cannot have the experience, this is that Devadatta. So, the object is in front of you, at the same time, it involves a kind of samskara also. The samskara also is revived, otherwise, you cannot relate the person standing in front of you as the one whom you have met earlier. So, this, in all cases of Pratyabhijna, what happens is there is a kind of samskara involved and Pratyakshanubhava also. Now, if the definition were to merely say samskara janyam jnanam smritihi, there is no matrapada. So, samskara janyam jnanam smritihi means, in as much as Pratyabhijna arising from samskara, you can call this Pratyabhijna as samskara janya. Forget about this Pratyakshanubhava. Whether this factor or this feature is present in Pratyabhijna or not, yes, it is samskara janya. So if you say samskara janyam jnanam is smriti, then exactly similar consideration applies to Pratyabhijna also, because that is also samskara janyam jnanam. So to exclude the possibility of the definition being applicable in the case of Pratyabhijna, what do? You want to restrict the scope of definition to smriti alone. So you introduce the word matra, samskara matra janyam jnanam smritihi means, then the definition would be applicable only to smriti, because in the case of Pratyabhijna, it is not samskara matra janya, because what one more feature is there, it is anubhava janyascha samskara janyam pratyaksha anubhava, pratyaksha also is involved there. So Pratyabhijna is not samskara matra janya. On the other hand, it is smriti alone that is samskara matra janya. So with that in view, he says samskara matra janyam yad jnanam तत् स्मरणम् संस्कार मात्र जन्यम यद् ज्ञानम् स्मरणम् उच्यते. एंड देन इन दिस कॉन्टेक्स्ट ही गोज टू एक्सप्लेन व्हाट आर दी थ्री what is meant by a definition at all, because you have been speaking of definitions, you have defined smriti. Sir, the mudichute sir last. So what is meant by a definition? You have been defining smriti, anubhava, all these. What is meant by a definition? The nayayikas alone have thought of providing a definition for a definition. See, we have been framing definitions for so many objects. What is meant by a definition of a definition? So the nayayikas thought of a definition, to provide a definition for a definition. So they say, what is meant by a definition? Lakshyamatra vrittihi dharmaha lakshanam. A definition is one which is present or which exists only in the object defined. So that alone could be an exclusive definition. So now we go on to see what is meant by a definition. And in the commentary, if you look into, naru kim nama lakshanam tena jnatena kim siddhyati iti chet uchyate. So what is meant by a definition, and by knowing which, what do you arrive at? What is the purpose of a definition? So he says, lakshyamatra vrittihi dharmaha lakshanam. That is the definition of definition.
Just an observation, you
No. You see, no. Unwanted or wanted? No. You see, there is even in the case of a jivan mukta, we have accepted. The Advaitins say there is what is known as viparita bhavana. A jivan mukta who has conquered everything and who has reached up to that stage, even sometimes what happens is because of his latent impressions. No, viparita bhavana. Viparita bhavana means there are so many samskaras which he has experienced in the earlier births or even prior to the rise of the knowledge of Brahman. He has had so many experiences, you know. So, that avidya is not capable of removing all the vasanas. There are still some vasanas left over. That is called, that could be conquered or that could be removed only by the practice of nididhyasana or meditation. That's what they say. So, viparita bhavana, Mysore Hiriyanna translates it as there is an unconscious reassertion of old habits of thought. Even if you don't want it, you know, what happens is it comes off its own accord. Whenever you sit to do kind of japa or meditation, you don't make any effort, you don't put in any effort, but then it comes off its own accord. That is because of the vasana. So, see, you see, anything is very easy, but to come over this vasanas, you know, that is very, very difficult. Who? You see, in the case of a jnani, what happens is,
without experiencing the fear.
Yes. You see, because of karana doshas, a jnani is a jnani, no doubt. But there is no guarantee that he will not mistake a piece of shell for silver. Okay? Now, I will explain it this way. An ordinary person mistakes a shell for silver, and he runs after that to pick it up. Now, he comes back and stands in the same position. Now also he sees that object. It appears as silver. But for the second time, he doesn't run after it because he has once for all realized the true nature of that object. He doesn't run after it. When this is the case with an ordinary person, what to speak of a jnani? He has once for all realized the true nature of the world, that illusory nature of the world. So he will not run after the world. Because he is constantly, he perceives the world to be unreal. So, in the case of a jnani, if you put me the question whether he will have erroneous cognition, that is bound to happen because of karana doshas, you know, he may mistake a piece of shell for silver. That may happen. There is no guarantee that he should not mistake a piece of, rope for a snake. All that would happen. But at any rate, no, he will, okay, this is an erroneous cognition, he will come to know that this is an erroneous cognition. All that is bound to happen. But in the case of the illusoriness of the world, he has realized that the world is illusory, so he will not run, even if he, see, it doesn't matter for him, no, whether it is a rope or snake, even if it is a snake, he will walk on it, it doesn't matter for him, you know. He will not be afraid of it. Because everything is, that is what happened in the case of Parikshit, you know. Because once he, you realize that everything is unreal, you are not going to be afraid of anything. So shall we proceed further now? I think we have had enough time for discussion. Now in this context, asadharana dharma is lakshana, sayeva asadharana dharma ityuchyate, he said. Now, this asadharana dharma is one. Sir, you will get the answer for your question. Now, asadharana dharma, this is the lakshana or the definition, defining feature. Now, this is a dharma, and we have given sasna or dewlap as the asadharana dharma of cow. Now, the logicians say that this an asadharana dharma is one which is free from the three defects of ativyapti, means over pervasion. Avyapti or partial inapplicability. Asambhava total inapplicability. So, we know for certainty that a defining feature which is called asadharana dharma is one which is present. Earlier we have stated that it pervades all the objects that are defined and is not present in any other objects that are not defined. Alakshya padartha, it should not be present in, it should be present in all the lakshya padarthas and should not be present in alakshya padarthas. This is the explanation we have given. So now we are giving counter examples. Now if something is given as the definition, now cow sasnavattam gova lakshanam, that is the correct definition. Now let us try to explain these defects, and an asadharana dharma is one which is free from these three defects we have to show. Now let us give first explain what is meant by ativyapti. It is over pervasion. Now see, the universe of Nayayikas consists of 1 to 10 cows. There are 10 cows we have to define. Now, what is the definition of a cow? We say, Goshu Kapilatvam. No, first is Avyapti, Chatushpatvam. Okay, Chatushpatvam. What is the definition of a cow? A child is asked this question. It is a four-footed animal, it says. A cow is that which is four-footed. If you give this as the definition, no doubt it is present in all the 10 cows. All the 10 cows are four-footed. But unfortunately, there are so many animals which are four-footed. buffalo, goat, all the animals are four-footed animals. So this definition will suffer from the fallacy, will suffer from the defect of over-pervasion. Over-pervasion means it not only exists in all the objects that are defined, but it is present in objects other than those that are defined, that is buffalo, goat, elephant. All these are chatushpa. In fact, all the animals are chatushpatva. So chatushpatvam, four-footed, possessed of 4 foot, this constitutes the definition of cow means, then this definition will not be an exclusive definition of cow. It will be present in animals other than cows also. Is it clear? So, is it clear, madam? So, chatushpatam, second, I am explaining the second one now. Lakshyavritti dharmasya alakshyavrittitvam ativyaptihi means the feature which is to be present in all the objects that are to be defined. If it is, unfortunately, if it is present, not only present here, it is present in objects other than those that are defined, then such a kind of defect is called over-pervasion. Over-pervasion means it pervades the entire objects that are to be defined, and it pervades, or it is present in objects that are different from the ones that are defined. So it is called over-pervasion. Ativyapti means it pervades other than those that are defined. Then such a definition is called ativyapti. So this cannot be treated as the definition of cow. You give up this definition because it suffers the defect of ativyapti. Is it all right? So that is why he says lakshyavritti dharmasya. The second line you see, lakshyavritti dharmasya. Lakshyavritti dharmasya means what is the lakshyavritti dharma? Chatushpatva. If that is present in alakshya vritti dharmam, if it happens to be related to alakshya padarthas, if it is present in buffalo, goat, elephant, etc., then this chatushpatva is called ativyapta dharma. It is a feature which suffers the defect of ativyapti. So you cannot treat this as the definition. No doubt it is present in all the cows. You want that, but we have already stated that it must be an exclusive feature. But this does not satisfy that condition. It is not an exclusive feature. It is present in all animals other than those that are defined. So this is not a definition. So if it is not a definition, why? What is the answer you are giving? It is ativyakti dosha dushta. It is associated with the defect called ativyakti. Is it all right? Now, the second one is atra lakshya ekadesha vrittitve sati lakshya ekadesha avrittitvam avyaptihi. The first he gives is this as the first. I told ativyakti as the first one. Avyapti he gives first. You see that line. Lakshya ekadesha vrittitve sati lakshya ekadesha avrittitvam avyaptihi. See, let us maintain 10 cows only. Now, from 1 to 10, till 9th cow, there is kapilatva. Kapilatva is given as the definition. Suppose we give up this definition. Chatushpatva is an ativyapta dharma. Okay, let me think of something else. Okay, I will give kapilatva as the definition. This is the definition that is given. Kapilatva means tawny color. Tawny color. Kapilagau. So kapilatva is given as the definition of or shweta rupavattam goho lakshanam. White color. Possession of white color is the definition of a cow means. It may exist in 9 cows. Even if it is not present in the 10th cow, then we cannot treat this as a definition. Because, see, partial inapplicability means don't think that equally it is present in 5 cows and it is not present in other 5. It is not the case. Even if it is not present in a single instance, then it must be treated as partial inapplicability. That is, you are duty bound to answer or you are duty bound to accommodate this definition in all the objects defined. So, without leaving a single instance. So, even if one object does not possess that definition, then you have to give up that definition. That is why he says, lakshya ekadesha. Lakshya ekadesha means till 1st to 9th cow, this is ekadesha, one part. This is another part. So ekadesha vrittitva, kapilatva is present in all the nine cows. Lakshya ekadesha vrittitva, and the other part, this is another ekadesha. Lakshya ekadesha vrittitve sati, lakshya ekadesha avrittitvam. The kapilatva is ekadesha vritti, it is partially present, and in the other part it is not present. So lakshya ekadesha vrittitve sati, lakshya ekadesha avrittitvam avyaptihi. So ekadesha means we tend to understand, ekadesha means in one part means it must be equally divided. It is not the case. You have to answer, even if in one single instance the definition is not present, means then you have to give up the definition. You cannot treat kapilatva as the definition of cow, because it is present. Nine cows in the universe of the Nayayikas are tawny color, but unfortunately that the 10th cow is white color. So how can you define cows as possessing tawny color? Kapilatva cannot be treated. So this is an instance he gives. How, if you give such an example or such a defining feature, then it is bound to suffer the defect of avyapti. I will give you another instance. See, gandhavattvam prithivyaha lakshanam. This is the definition which the Nyaya school gives. Possession of odor, this constitutes the definition of prithvi. You see, all the objects of prithvi are possessed of odor without leaving a single instance. But see the academic honesty of the Nyaya school. They themselves anticipate a question. They say, according to the Nyaya school, any object, during the first moment of its origination, it remains without any quality or activity. This is a niyama or maxim they have admitted. Any substance, at the first moment of its origination, utpannam dravyam, kshanam, agunam, akriyam cha tishtati, it is not possessed of any quality or activity whatsoever. So viewed in the light of this maxim, pot at the time of its origination, for the first moment, it will not be noticed, it is unnoticed, nobody can notice it. But it is a logical necessity for the Nayayikas that at the first moment it remains without any quality or activity. So the Nayayikas are academically honest, and they say in the first moment pot will not possess any gandha. So pot, as associated with the first moment of its origination, is devoid of gandha, means then there is the avyapti. The definition suffers from the defect of avyapti. You see, I am speaking of the 10th cow as a whole, but the Nayayikas think of even a kshana, he cannot leave. If you define prithvi as one possessing gandha, it must be present in all the objects without leaving a single instance, as conditioned by time, space, everything. But here is an instance, the Nayayikas themselves admit that in the first moment of its origination, it remains without quality or activity. So utpatti kshanava chinna gata, the pot as associated with the first moment of its origination, is devoid of gandha. So there is avyapti for the definition of prithvi in the first moment of origination of any substance for that matter. So the Nayayikas amend the definition of prithvi, gandhavattam prithivyaha lakshanam, that they leave out the definition of prithvi and they amend the definition, they refreshen in a different way, which I am not. What I wanted to convey is, without leaving a single instance, means the Nyaya school, they are not tolerant of leaving even a single moment for the definition to suffer from the fallacy. What to speak of a unit as such, the 10th cow does not possess tawny color at all, means we cannot leave this as a definition. So kapilatva also is pushed out from our purview. So this also doesn't satisfy our definition. So it is avyapti dharma, avyapta dharma. So it also suffers the defect of avyapti. Now, what is the third type of defect? Asambhava means total inapplicability. You are asked to, a child is asked to spell school. What is the spelling of school? Suppose the child has W, A, it spells water. So instead of school, it spells water, means like that. If you are asked to define a cow, cows are possessed of two hooves. If you are asked to define a cow, well, ekashapavatva is the definition of a cow. Those animals which possess only one hoof, one hoofed animal is a cow. If you say, then that is a total impossibility, total inapplicability. The definition will not at all be present in any cows. You can go Triloka Sanchara, even if you do, you cannot find any cow possessing one hoof. It is only the horses that possess one hoof. So a cow is a one hoofed animal, if you say so, then it is a total inapplicability. This definition will not at all satisfy, will not at all be present in any of the animals, any of the cows. So it suffers the fallacy of asambhava. So now from this we deduce chatushpatva is ativyapta dharma, kapilatva is avyapta dharma, ekashapavatva is asambhava dharma. It is asambhava dharma. So a definition is one which is free from the three defects of ativyapti, avyapti and asambhava. So this chatushpatva cannot be viewed as a definition because it is an ativyapta dharma. Kapilatva is not a definition because it is an avyapta dharma. And asambhava also is not a definition. Ekashapavatva also is not a definition because it is an asambhava dharma. Now coming to this sasnavatva, this sasnavatva is present in all the cows that are defined. It is not present in animals other than cows, and it is not present only in part of the cows, in the other part it is not present, it's not the case. And so there is no asambhava also. So it is free from the three defects of ativyapti, avyapti and asambhava. So the sasnavatva is called asadharana dharma, and it is the correct definition of cow. So we must be very cautious in choosing that as a defining feature which is free from the three defects of ativyapti and avyapti and asambhava. So when you are asked to define something, immediately you cannot hurriedly say that this is the definition. You must look into it that it does not suffer these three kinds of defects. Then only you can conclude that such and such a factor is the definition. Now you look into the text. Atra lakshya, I will go one by one. Atra lakshya ekadesha vritti, first is avyapti. In the book it is given, avyapti is given. Lakshya ekadesha vrittitve sati, lakshya ekadesha avrittitve. Ekadesha vritti, first from first cow to ninth cow, kapilatva is present. So ekadesha vrittitve sati, ekadesha avrittitvam avyaptihi, yata goshu kapilatvam. If you define cows as possessing kapilatva, kapila rupa, then that is an avyapti dosha dushta dharma. And then lakshya vritti dharmasya alakshya vrittitvam avyaptihi. If the defining feature which is present in all the lakshya padarthas, if it happens to exist in alakshya vritti, objects that are different from those that are defined, then such a feature is called ativyapti. Yata goshu chatushpatvam, chatushpatvam means four footed animal is a cow, if you say so, then it suffers the defect of ativyapti. And then what is asambhava? Lakshye kvapi avartanam asambhava, in none of the places, in none of the objects defined it exists, then such a feature is called asambhava. Kvapyavartanam asambhavaha yata goshu ekashapavatvam. Then he concludes by saying etat dushana traya rahitaha dharmaha lakshanam iti paryavasyati. Paryavasyati means finally we conclude by saying that a defining feature is one which is different, or which is devoid of these three doshas. Etat dushana traya means what are the dosha traya? Ativyapti, avyapti and asambhava. Etat dushana traya rahitaha dharmaha lakshanam iti paryavasyati. So how do you define a definition? What is the definition of a definition? Dushana traya rahitaha dharmaha lakshanam sayeva asadharana dharma ityuchyate. So now we have given the definition of a definition. What is the definition of a definition? Dushana traya rahita hai. Definition is one which should be devoid or free from the three defects of ativyapti, avyapti and asambhava, and that alone is referred to as asadharana dharmaha. So etat dushana traya rahita dharmaha lakshanam iti paryavasyati prakrite. Now this is, we have taken a deviation, isn't it? Prasangat ativyapti, avyapti and asambhava does not come in our normal regular course. So because we have said what is meant by lakshana, and lakshana prasangat, we have to explain what is meant by. In order to understand lakshana, we have to understand what are the three defects. So we have taken a deviation, you see. Now prakritam anusaramaha, we come back. You see, in Vedanta, if you look into the commentaries, the commentator sometimes he will take a deviation from the main text. He will be commenting on something from the Mula Grantha. The commentator himself will feel that it requires some kind of explanation. He will keep on explaining it. And then he will come back to the original Grantha, wherever he has left, you know. So, if you look in some text, it would have been written, Simhavalokanan Nyayena. There is a maxim, Simhavalokanan Nyaya. Puramimamsa maxim, there are so many maxims which the Puramimamsakas have framed. Gattagutti Prabhata Nyaya, Simhavalokana Nyaya, Suchi Kataha Nyaya, Stali Pulaka Nyaya. So the commentators use such nyayas, maxims. Now what is this Simhavalokana Nyaya? Whenever the commentator takes a deviation from the main text, and then he comes back from to where he has left earlier, there it is called Simhavalokana Nyaya. Means the simha or the lion, it goes far beyond its den. It comes out of its den and it goes far beyond its den. And with a heavy sigh, it looks back its den. So this is simha avalokanam. Because the drishti of simha, you can just imagine. Simha avalokana nyaya. So that is why the commentators compare them. Simha avalokana nyaya means returning from the digression to the main point of discussion. We have taken a deviation. This is Bertrand Russell's usage. Returning from digression to the main point of discussion. Of course, he doesn't know Simhavalokana Nyaya, but he uses this expression, returning from the because whenever he digresses on something and he wants to come back to the original place where he left, he will use this expression, returning from the digression to the main point of discussion. This is precisely what is done in Simhavalokana Nyaya. That is what we have done here also. We have taken a deviation because we started with the definition of smriti. Smritehe lakshanamaha means immediately he recollects, he thought he should define what is meant by a lakshana, what are the three defects pertaining to it. All these things, no? We have gone, we have taken a deviation. That is, rather I should say, we have gone in the loop line. Now we have to come to the main line, main track we have to come. Wait. So etat dushanatraya rahitaha dharmaha lakshanam iti paryavasyati prakrite jnanattvam smritehe lakshanam chet. Now why have you explained ativyapti, avyapti, all these? So he says prakrite jnanattvam smritehe lakshanam chet. We have defined smriti as samskara itara ajanyatve sati samskara janyattvam smritehe lakshanam. This is the definition we have given. Supposing we give jnanattvam smritehe lakshanam, instead of breaking our head with such a long definition, suppose we want to say, well, smriti is a kind of knowledge. Smriti is a kind of knowledge. What would happen if I give such a definition? Jnanattvam smritehe lakshanam. Sir, please don't give such a definition. I have just now read ativyapti, avyapti and asambhava. If you define smriti as one that is possessed of jnanattva, then immediately there is a serious difficulty. It will be over pervading in anubhava. Anubhava is also a type of knowledge. So it will not serve as an exclusive definition of smriti. So jnanattvam smritehe lakshanam chet anubhave ativyaptihi. So that is why iti samskara janyati. That is why we have defined smriti as samskara matra janyam jnanam smritihi. Now samskara dvamse ativyapti varanaya jnana padam pratibhijnayam ativyapti varanaya matra padam. Before I explain that, you wanted to ask some question, isn't it? Yeah, please. That I will explain later. then you don't call it as a definition, that is all. See, we are here to provide a correct definition. Oh, don't worry about that. Sasna is cut off means. No. See, generally speaking, Sasna, a cow, is that which possesses. See, Shrungitva is the definition of cow, means Shrunga is not at all. There means there are some cows which do not possess horns at all. No, we are not worried about that. Generally speaking, cows are possessed of dew lap. See, normally a person is possessing two legs and two hands. Suppose one hand is cut off, that doesn't mean that you are not calling him as a man or a person, you know. That is totally different. We are not worried about that, those instances. We are only speaking, we are only concerned about instances where these are present. Those are very limited cases, you know, that you have to overlook. They will not disturb our regular this thing. Now, we have 10 more minutes. No, we have 20 minutes, I think. So, this last line needs some explanation. Now look into the last line of this verse commentary. Samskara dvamse ativyapti varanaya jnana padam pratyabhijnayam ativyapti varanaya matra padam. What is the definition of smriti? Samskara matra. We will have this simple definition. Samskara itara janyatva will not, because he deals with this definition only. Samskara matra janyam jnanam smritihi. So recollection is cognition or knowledge which arises only from samskara. This is the meaning of this sentence. Is it all right? Now let us go to the process in which smriti arises. Anubhava leaves out an impression. Impression is samskara. And that gives rise to recollection. Now, it is always the habit of the Nayayikas to analyze the definition. Whatever definition he gives the purpose of each and every phrase of that syllabus. I'm sorry, of that definition. So here he analyzes samskara matra janyam jnanam smriti means this definition consists of two segments. Samskara matra janyatva is one aspect. That is, in smriti, there are two aspects. That it arises from samskara and it possesses jnanatva. So smriti or recollection is a kind of cognition which possesses jnanatva and which possesses samskara matra janyatva, means it arises from samskara alone. This feature is present in recollection, and jnanatva also is present in recollection. Now let us call this as A and this as B. There are two components in this definition. Now what is the need for the component A and what is the need for component B? That he analyzes. So he says, samskara. Now somebody asked the question, jnanatva matroktav. What does it matter if we say that jnanam smritihi? Jnanattvam smritehe lakshanam. Smriti is a kind of cognition. Smriti is a kind of knowledge. So what does it matter if I say so? Just now we read that it must be an exclusive definition, should not over pervade. So if we give this B, if we supply B alone as the definition of smriti, then the definition will be over applicable in the case of anubhava, because anubhava also possesses this jnanatva. Anubhava is also a kind of knowledge, isn't it? So jnanatvam smrutehe lakshanam, if we say, then unfortunately jnanatva is present in anubhava also. So you have not provided an exclusive definition for smriti, so the definition suffers the defect of ativyapti. Where is it ativyapta? It is over pervaded in the definition in anubhava. So we have to provide something else as the definition. So we prefix the word jnanatva with samskara matra janyatva. If this A component is provided, added in the definition, then anubhava does not possess this element. Samskara matra janyatva is not present in anubhava, so the definition will be intact. There is no over pervasion in anubhava, so this is a correct definition. But now there is a pertinent question. In order to ward off ativyapti in anubhava, we have provided this element, this component. Now what does it matter if we do away with this and just merely say samskara matra janyatva? Because even if we don't refer to smriti as a kind of knowledge, we know that it is a kind of knowledge. Why should we specify it as jnana? Samskara matra janyam smritihi. Samskara matra janyatvam smritehe lakshana, if we say so, what is wrong? Then the Nayayikas say, you see, samskara, when it gives rise to recollection or smriti, what happens is, samskara and smriti cannot coexist together. If there is recollection, that means samskara is not there, because samskara has taken the form of smriti. And when smriti goes away, it will leave out a samskara. And then when that samskara is revived, then there will be recollection. And when there is recollection, samskara cannot stand along with recollection. So that we have to understand. So when there is the recollection, when something is recollected, that means there is no samskara at all. Samskara has been destroyed so as to recollect that object. So how does samskara give rise to recollection? By when there is the destruction of samskara, and then only there arises recollection. Is it clear? So samskara, what happens is, samskara, in order to give recollection, there is samskara dhomsa or destruction of samskara. Only when there is a destruction of samskara, there would arise recollection. Now you may ask the question, if samskara is totally destroyed, how am I to recollect the object once again? That is why I told, recollection, when it goes away, it will leave out a samskara. Recollection will leave out a samskara. For the first instance alone, samskara arises from anubhava. As and when you recollect, the recollection will leave out a samskara when it goes away. Is it clear? Now, the point that is of relevance here, why I am telling this, is samskara dvamsa also arises from samskara. See, you can speak of ghatad dvamsa, destruction of pot, only when there is a pot. So in the same way, samskara dvamsa can take place only when there is samskara. So samskara dvamsa also is samskara janya. Just as recollection is samskara janya, in the same way, samskara dvamsa also is samskara janya. So if you provide this as the definition of recollection, the definition of recollection will be over pervasive in samskara dvamsa. Samskara dvamsa, abhava, is the seventh category according to the Nayayikas. Smriti comes under qualities, guna. So what is given as the definition of a particular quality, jnana quality, is over pervasive in the seventh category called samskara dvamsa, because samskara dvamsa also is samskara matra janya. It arises only from samskara. So samskara matra janya. So there is over pervasion for this definition. So in order to ward off that defect, you have to provide jnanatva or jnana in the definition. If this is provided, this B component, if it is provided, then although samskara dvamsa is arises from samskara, yet it does not possess this aspect. It is not a type of knowledge. It is the seventh category, isn't it? Dvamsa, dvamsa rupo abhava, praga bhava, pradvamsa bhava, atyanta bhava, anyonya bhava. There are four types of abhava. You will be reading that. So dvamsa is the seventh category. There is no jnanatva in dvamsa, so there is no ativyapti. So finally what we conclude is both the A component as well as the B component, both of them are required in order to define recollection or smriti. So samskara matra janyam jnanam smritihi. So both the components have some purpose. If jnanatva alone is given, then there is the defect of ativyapti in anubhava. If samskara matra janyatva is given, then there is the defect of ativyapti in samskara dvamsa. So both are essential in order to define recollection or smriti. That is what he says, prakrite jnanatvam smritehe lakshanam chet anubhave ativyapti iti samskara janyeti. So in order to ward off that samskara janyeti, samskara dvamse ativyapti varanaya jnana padam, the word jnana is. Then one more thing is there. Okay, samskara janyam jnanam smritihi. This will satisfy the definition of smriti. Why have you included the word matra? This seems to be an unwanted element here. Samskara matra janyam jnanam smritihi. Samskara janyam jnanam. Why do you unnecessarily use this? See, about the vayakaranas, there is a saying in Sanskrit. Ardhamatra lagavam putrotsavam manyante vayakaranaha. Even if they are able to compensate with one syllable, no, if they are able to do away with one syllable, ardhamatra lagavam putrotsavam, they will feel that it is equal to putrotsava. They have got a son. Putrotsavam manyante vayakaranaha. In the same way, the nayayikas also will not use unnecessarily futile. They will never use any, even a single syllable unnecessarily. So why the word matra is included in the definition? Samskara janyam jnana smritihi, it satisfies the definition of smriti. So for that, he says, if samskara matra pada is, let us forget for a moment, the word matra is not here. Samskara janyam jnana smriti, there is a kind of cognition called pratyabhijna. Pratyabhijna is reminiscence or recognition. The usual example that is given is, he is that Devadatta, so I am Devadatta. So I am Devadatta. Yesterday I saw Devadatta at Ernakulam railway station. Today he has come to attend the class. Now I am able to recollect. Yesterday I saw him at the station. The same person has come here. Now there is an element of both pratyaksha anubhava as well as recollection. If the person in front of me, if I am not able to recollect that he is the same person whom I met yesterday at the station, then I cannot say he is that Devadatta. So I am seeing him in front of me. This is not a case of smriti. But the very fact that I am able to recognize him as Devadatta means that I have recollected seeing him yesterday at the station. So pratyabhijna is a mixture, is a combination of anubhava and smriti. Or in other words, pratyaksha, perception, and smriti. In as far as you are able to recollect Devadatta and identify the person in front of you as the one whom you have met earlier, yesterday, there is the element of recollection. There is the element of samskara rather. Let me not put it as smriti. It is samskara. There is the impression. Because Devadatta whom I have seen yesterday has left an impression in me. That is why I am able to associate that Devadatta with the person in front of me today. So now, here also, if the word matra is not given, this pratyabhijna also is an instance of knowledge which arises from samskara. Of course, there is the additional element of pratyaksha also there, but the definition specifies samskara janyam jnanam smritihi. So in as much as this element is present in pratyabhijna, samskara janyam jnanam, so the samskara janyatva, that element is here and it is a kind of knowledge. So this pratyabhijna also may have to be treated as recollection. So in order to ward off the definition being over applicable in the case of pratyabhijna, the word matra is included in the definition. Now in the case of pratyabhijna, it is not samskara matra janya, it is anubhava janyascha, because you are seeing the person in front of you. It is not samskara alone that gives rise to pratyabhijna. An element, additional element is there, that means the object is in front of you, so it is anubhava janyascha. So samskara matra janya, the word matra is specified or included in the definition to ward off ativyapti in the case of recognition or reminiscence or pratyabhijna. So the word, along with the word matra, samskara matra janyam jnanam smritihi. So I think we have analyzed this syllable by syllable, samskara matra janyam jnanam smritihi. This serves as an exclusive definition of recollection or smriti. So with that, tattad vishayaka jnanam dvividam parikirtitam samskara matra janyam yad jnanam smaranam uchyate, then anubhavam lakshayati. That we will see the next class. Yes. Which one? You recollect something, that will be connect, an instance of smriti alone. Only thing is the object, if the object is in front of you, then you cannot call it as smriti. It is a kind of pratyabhijna. Not even pratyabhijna. If you are able to recollect and associate, oh, he is the same person, then it is a pratyabhijna. See, as a matter of fact, the object of recollection will not be presented in your cognition. That is, it is not in front of you. The very fact that you are recollecting something means it implies the absence of the non-presence of the object. If the object is in front of you, then it is not recollection. Then it is called, it is a case of pratyabhijna. Is it okay? Yes? Which one? Other than? No, pratyaksha, the object is in front of you. Object is in front of you, and there is udbodha, udbuddha samskara is there. Samskara as associated with anubhava gives rise to pratyabhijna. Pratyaksha is not udbodha. You are seeing the person. What is udbuddha is only the samskara. See, yesterday I have seen that person, there is no samskara in me, means even if you bring him here, I will not be able to recollect. Oh, is it so? Did I see you? If I ask, then he will be a miserable person. Madam, yesterday you were talking to me. What is it? You have forgotten me totally. So there is no samskara at all, means even if you bring him here, that pratyaksha will not be. It is just a kind of experience, that is all. It cannot be called pratyabhijna. Pratyabhijna comes only when you are able to associate the past experience, and when there is the revival, along with that you are able to, soyam devadattaha, means if you are able to recollect and recognize the person that he is the same, then it is pratyabhijna. But these are all offshoots of jnana only. Basically, jnana is of two types, anubhava. Anubhava, the element of anubhava is there in pratyabhijna. So we cannot be including anubhava, pratyabhijna, upeksha, jnana. There are so many other cognitions, apeksha, buddhi. There are so many, all these are avantara, prabedas, no? Some internal varieties. But generally speaking, it can either be of anubhava or smriti, that is all. That itself, we have to break our head. Why do you want to include all those under? Then he will start.